Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Opportunity and Challenge, the Ethical Implications of Generative Artificial Intelligence for Psychologists. I'm Lindsay Childress-Beatty. I'm APA's Chief of Ethics. Thank you so much for joining us. We know everyone has busy lives, and we really appreciate your time and attention. This is the inaugural session of APA's new webinar series on generative AI. Generative AI is posed to revolutionize how psychologists approach their work. We think it'll be a game changer. APA has recognized this pivotal role generative AI is set to play and has dedicated significant resources to align our efforts with this technological revolution in accordance with our strategic plan. We're especially mindful of the importance of considering ethics as the use of generative AI develops. To realize its full potential, AI must be managed with attention to ethics, including the community impact and the biases and inequities its use could amplify. In addition, because of the important work that psychologists engage in, ethical issues specific to psychologists, such as confidentiality and competence, must be considered. This is why it was important to start the generative AI conversation with a session focused on ethics. I'd now like to introduce our esteemed panelists for today's discussion. And we've put this in reverse chronological order just to shake things up a little bit. So Dr. Richard N. Landers is the John P. Campbell Distinguished Professor of Industrial Organizational Psychology at the University of Minnesota and Principal Investigator of the TNT Lab, which is testing new technologies in learning, assessment, and behavior. Dr. Jessica Jackson is an award-winning licensed psychologist and mental health equity advocate. She's the founder of the Dr. J. Lauren Psychological and Consultation Services, a Houston, Texas-based mental health practice providing expert care and consultation. Dr. Regan A.R. Garung is Associate Vice Provost and Executive Director of the Center for Teaching and Learning, a Professor of Psychological Science, and Director of the General Psychology Program at Oregon State University. And Dr. Tiffany Cheneville is the Marie E. and E. Leslie Cole Endowed Chair in Ethics and Professor of Psychology and Pediatrics at the University of South Florida. And she is a former chair of the APA Ethics Committee. So thank you all panelists for joining us today. I thought it would be helpful to quickly outline the plan for this panel discussion. We'll start with a very quick poll of attendees to gauge level of experience with generative AI and in what settings you're using it. Then we will begin the panel discussion. We'll explain what we mean by generative AI. We'll talk about its use in various areas of psychology and what some of the benefits might be. And then we'll discuss the ethics issues, both for society in general and then those specific to psychology. If we have time, we'll answer questions from the Q&A. However, given all the great questions that were submitted by you as you registered, we may not get to any of these additional questions. We tried instead to include those responses to the questions in our remarks. Also, you'll note in the slide that we included the QR code so that you can read the APA ethics code, and that way you have it if you want to refer to it during the session. So let's start with a quick poll. Please take a moment to list the response that best fits your past experience. Okay, hopefully everyone's had a chance to answer the poll, and we'll take a look at the results. All right, so not a lot of you are using it often, but 14% is actually pretty good. And mainly if you're using it for work and school. It would be interesting to know how much of that is work and how much of that are the graduate students that are using it. And then a lot of you have tried it out, but don't use it often. And then about a quarter of you have not experimented with it at all. So you're brand new to this issue. So hopefully this will be helpful for all of you in all of these different areas of use. Okay, so let's begin with a summary of what we mean when we say generative AI. What's generative about it, and how does it differ from other artificial intelligence? So Richard, could you help explain that to us?
Sure can. I think to understand what generative AI is, we have to contrast it with traditional AI. Traditional AI has only really been around for a little while and be a little bit of a confusing concept. So let me go back to basics just a little bit. AI is really a very general term. It refers to any technology that we use to mimic something that previously we thought only humans could do. So one of the most familiar to people now is probably vehicle routing AI, things like Google Maps. So if you open up Google Maps, you give it a location, you give it a destination, it pulls in data about traffic and road conditions, and it gives you a route. So AI, including things like maps, it's not really intelligent in the way we usually use that word talking about humans. It's instead an example of what we would call a predictive model, something fundamentally about predicting data from other data. And in this case, it's basically predicting where people should turn along a route. So if you took stats in like psych undergrad or grad school, you probably learned about regression. That's actually the most fundamental kind of predictive AI. And the most common AIs we have now are essentially very complicated types of regression. Sometimes layering regressions in and out of each other, predicting each other, it gets quite complicated, but at the core of it, it's really about predicting numbers from other numbers. So where generative AI is different is that instead of predicting one number, we're predicting something unstructured and complicated, like text or images or sound or video. And we're also doing it from a much larger number of predictors and larger data sets than we've historically used. So for example, the way that ChatGPT works is that you're basically predicting a single word from other words, and then it repeats that process a bunch of times. So like right now, if you go into ChatGPT and you enter a two-word prompt, hip hip, the output you're going to get is hooray, because that is the most likely word to follow hip hip. If you enter a three-word prompt, like how are you, the output I will pretty much guarantee will be something like thanks for asking, because that is the most likely set of words to come after that. And importantly, what it's doing is that it's actually doing that one word at a time. So when you ask how are you, the most likely word to come after that is thanks. And then it re-predicts how are you, thanks, what comes after that, for, how are you, thanks, for, and it says the most likely word after that, asking. So it's actually doing three separate predictions to create what you're seeing. So it's under the hood doing all this kind of like predictive modeling, but what you see is just the output in text. And so how does it do that? Well, it's using a very complicated, very large data set consisting more or less of the entire internet. Every public web page, Twitter, Reddit, Google Books, basically everything that that the creators could get access to in order to create this very complicated regression model. And whereas in psychology, we often run regressions with like two variables or five or 10, GPT-4, which is part of the ChatGPT platform, has 1.7 trillion with a T. So it's the interactive complexity between that massive number of variables that lets us get such diverse kinds of responses out of a generative AI, where it seems like it's able to actually, it seems like it's able to think. It's very good at fooling us into us thinking that it's almost a human-like response, but it's really just this very high complexity prediction to create that kind of content. And importantly, Gen AI is not limited to text. You can give images or PDFs to ChatGPT and you can get text out the other end. You can use software like Midjourney and you can give it a text prompt and output a picture. One that I like to use in my presentations is a prompt that says, give me a painting of a koala in the style of Salvador Dali. And if you give it that prompt, it will give you exactly what you expect that would look like. You can use software like Synesthesia to generate a video of a person giving a lecture. That's not terrible. It's still not perfect. If you watch Synesthesia videos, you got a little bit of a like, I'm pretty sure that's not a human, but it's getting real close. And within the next few years, you probably won't be able to tell. So Gen AI as a general topic, it's huge. It's really about taking these high complexity, massive data sets and creating predictions of unstructured output. And it's not just copy pasting from source material. It's literally creating brand new predictions based on this giant model that it's created. But that's what all Gen AI has in common. And that's the problem that we're trying to explore now, how to use that the best.
Thanks so much, Richard. That was really helpful to kind of give us that overview of generative AI. So I think the first thing we want to talk about as a panel is how generative AI will benefit the work of psychologists. And I thought we could start with education. For example, in education, in what ways will generative AI support the work of educators? So what are some of the positives of generative AI in education? Regan, do you have any thoughts on that in particular?
Absolutely. A lot of thoughts, and I'll try not to take up the rest of the webinar with it. But to start off, I think there are just so many places that we can all, as faculty and teachers and educators, use AI. I mean, I'll just give you a couple of really quick ones. First off, I think, you know, and I want to segue right from what Richard talked about. If you want to know, you know, how your assignments are doing, the very first thing I'd suggest all of you listening do is put some of your assignments into AI and see what they respond, right? Simple, quick thing. Do it. See what it actually says. Now, maybe you've written an assignment and you go, gosh, I would love some help grading this. So what would be a good rubric for this? Well, you just put the prompt in into AI and you can actually get very good rubrics for a variety of assignments. So right off the bat, I think if you are stumbling or struggling to go, how do I assess something? What would be a good way to ask about topics or to assess a student's learning in a topic? Right now, we have AI. Ask AI that question and almost guaranteed you'll get some good food for thought and many ideas for how you can change your assignments. So assignments, assessment, big places to go. I'll just throw out two other ones real quickly. I loved the Salvador Dali koala, but there's now AI that can put presentations together for you. There's now AI where it can take a research article and summarize it for you, or even help take a research article and put it into words that an eighth grader or anywhere on words, you just said it, can understand. So it's all, the way I like to think about this is AI is sort of like that esteemed, educated friend that you could always turn to. But here's a friend you can ask 24/7 and will give you a response way faster than the best friend that you probably have. So I'll leave it there for starters.
Thanks, Regan. I wonder if anyone else on the panel wants to comment. I know a lot of you are educators, so you may have thoughts.
Yeah, I was just thinking of it. There's the benefits to the educators, and then, of course, there's the benefits to the students. And, of course, there are concerns about student use of generative AI in the classroom. But on the benefit side, I do think there are a lot of potential benefits for student learning in terms of, well, just the example just given, you know, students could put in articles and have it explained in a way that they can actually receive the information, and they can get really creative with their work and understanding. So I do think there are benefits despite some of the challenges.
I think that the double-edged sword piece of this is very important. So just basically every threat that Gen AI brings, it also brings some potential. And you really have to change the way that you think about it in order to really realize it. So, like, for example, one of the things people worry about is the idea that you can, it's difficult to use multiple choice assessment because you can basically copy paste into ChatGPT and it will just tell you the answer. And beyond that, now you can actually take a phone and like take a snapshot with your smartphone and it will answer that question too. And so that's a big threat to a multiple choice style approach to assessment. But at the same time, you can also ask ChatGPT to give an explanation of why those answers are the right answers. And you can actually have a conversation with ChatGPT about, well, like, why is this answer wrong? And I thought it was going to be answer 4. Why was it answer 3? And it becomes an enormously powerful opportunity to get this customized one-on-one, almost tutoring or instruction that you otherwise just couldn't get. So, you know, for every discussion I ever hear about, like, you know, ChatGPT is fundamentally threatening education, it's also opening up so many more avenues for teaching, for learning, that we didn't really have before with the resources that we can devote to it. So it's just an enormous amount of potential in addition to the challenges it will certainly introduce as we learn to adapt to it.
Yeah, and adding to that too, I've done, you know, seen some writing about the virtual teaching assistant, which can benefit faculty who don't otherwise have access to teaching assistants. And again, it's just how do we use that in a way that is really productive?
Yeah, I just want to say one more thing. And Tiffany, I like the way you brought in students, right? Because I think it's really important to take the student perspective as well. And I'm really glad, Lindsay, that you started off with the benefits, because far too often the first thing many of us jump to and fear is what about cheating and academic dishonesty? And I'm sure we'll get there. But I think the one thing I want to say is, as educators, one of the toughest things that for us to do is generate examples of good responses to our own assignments. And quite honestly, I found for me personally, when students go, can you give me an example of what would be a good response to this assignment? Well, I put some of my assignments into ChatGPT and it came up with some wonderful examples that I could then modify, tweak, and then share with students and say, here are some really good examples. So I really think there's the efficacy, the efficiency that ChatGPT provides, but it's as long as you are weighing all those different things to keep in mind. And I know, you know, we talked about what we should weigh, and I know we'll get to that in this hour as well, but that's weighing it. But yes, absolutely. Let's focus on those positives.
Yeah, and the only thing I would add, Lindsay, is I think I agree that I appreciate you starting with the positive, is I would encourage people to also think about what part of using AI for positive feels challenging. So I think when we are saying something like the research article example, people are like, but using it to summarize an article feels like it's a problem. But most people, if they're honest, they're looking for the cliff notes of a research article anyway, right? In grad school, you were trained, you might read the first paragraph, the results section, and maybe the conclusion, right? You're not reading it often. So it's really just helping with a shortcut that we're already doing a lot of manual shortcuts in the work we do anyway. And so I encourage people to think about, like, what part of it feels different because it's AI compared to the shortcut I'm already doing for the work that I'm using.
Yeah, that's a great point, Jessica, to really think about, is it that different than what we're already doing with a different tool? Great point. All right, so what about in psychological practice with patients and clients? Now, I know there are obviously some ethical issues with that, but how could generative AI support that work, assuming we could get over any ethical hurdles? Does anybody have any thoughts on that?
Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, I think it's a great question. And to your point, the caveat, right, that there are things of ethical hurdles, making sure things are HIPAA compliant, all of that. So that caveat up front. But there are a lot of things that AI has the potential to do, and there are companies that are already starting to develop some of that. So for example, helping with notes, right? Notes are something that are difficult for many clinicians trying to fit in the time. There are different ways that AI can support. For some people, it takes notes during a session and then you're able to read over and take things out. For others, there's software that looks for themes. So you can start noticing themes that are coming up for you in your session with the patient that you're seeing, so you can focus on those. Others are looking for things like markers in your voice to indicate that you may be more likely to be thinking about suicide or something like that. So there are multiple ways that it can be used to help support clinical practice, even as a supplement in between sessions, having something that your patients can come and ask a question to. Often people need more than that 1 hour that they're getting to see you realistically every 3 or 4 weeks, right? A lot of people aren't actually getting weekly therapy or biweekly therapy. So how can it support in between? There's a lot of companies doing a lot of these things. I think the trick is making sure, and not even the trick, the key is to make sure, how is it being HIPAA compliant with people's information, the PHI, and how do we kind of adjust for that, right? So it's not the best idea for those who may have considered it. Don't use ChatGPT to write a note right now, because you would be putting somebody's information in there, right? So it's like, how do you find software that is built specifically for the work that we are doing to be able to leverage it?
Great point.
Yes, and I also was reading about, potential use of generative AI for detecting verbal and nonverbal cues in telehealth sessions. Again, there's a lot of privacy issues we've got to figure out, but I thought that was really interesting, so that some concerns exist about telehealth and what we're losing in that format. And so using it in that way. And then also kind of using generative AI and digital phenotyping data to, again, personalize treatment plans and do progress monitoring. So I think there's a lot of potential uses in practice that are kind of exciting to think about once we can figure out how to use those tools ethically.
Sounds great. And even without putting in any patient data, you can get a lot of good ideas from it that can start a treatment plan or that can start a note for you. So any other thoughts from any panelists on this question? This could be also in schools. This could be in with applied psychology. You know, so many areas of psychology could benefit from generative AI.
I think the other way is thinking about, when we think about practice and training, for anyone who's ever taught a course where they're practicing like a theories course or where you're the supervisor for clinical training, it can be difficult to find specific cases to help people get trained on, right? You have to find something that somebody's already written or you have something older to really think through what would this person say. And so I think it'd be a great opportunity for students to get training on things before they're actually meeting with people in what feels like a real-time scenario. Someone's giving a response, they're giving it back. It's a different way for us to think about that training, especially for some of the modalities that require more specialty, right? You think about some of the treatments for PTSD, and it takes a long time to get trained in like prolonged exposure or something like that. And if someone could practice before they actually get to a person, I think that would just make better clinicians. And so it's another way to think about it in practice, but also as a part of the education piece.
That's great. Any ideas for applied practice and research?
It's massive, incredible amount of opportunity. I do like this framing. I just want to throw out there that we start with benefits. I think it is very easy to come up with downsides, but there is a lot of potential in the research space, mostly in terms of time savings. I think right now the most obvious use case for generative AI is in creating materials, at least draft versions of materials that would otherwise take a very large amount of time to create. So, for example, right now, if you want to generate stimulus materials, like you want to have a block of text that you're going to show to research participants in a study, you're going to have to sit there and draft it out and think very cautiously about exactly how to phrase it. Whereas you can instead go to something like a GPT and say, hey, here's what I'm trying to accomplish. Give me a paragraph. And that's a wonderful starting point that saves you a huge amount of time on the back end. Similarly, more advanced types of generative AI can generate entire full-blown materials that we couldn't have before. So, for example, if you want to have video instructions and you want to put that in your web-based study, and you're like, man, if I go on camera, it's going to be stilted and painful, and I don't want to be like put my video on the internet. You can make that material for you to represent messages that you want to deliver within those research materials. You can use it to generate actual like stimulus materials, audio clips that have slightly different intonation, or you can systematically vary the apparent gender from the voice a person's using. I mean, just the amount of the ability to create materials is astonishing. There's also a wonderful equity dimension to it, because historically that's been limited to labs with funds. You had to be able to pay actors. You had to be able to hire folks to come in and create these high quality materials. And now that's become much more accessible to folks without those kinds of resources. Similarly, in the area of writing, I mean, I think this is actually one of the most wonderful parts of this. Right now, you know, English has become sort of the de facto default language of science, and that really shuts a lot of people out that are English as a second language or literally pick it up purely so that they can be part of these scientific conversations. And it's very trivial now to copy paste something in either your own language or your first pass at English into ChatGPT and say, hey, make this sound like a research article. Please fix it for me. And it will give you that immediately in a way that, you know, otherwise you would have to hire an editor or get coaching or all sorts of very expensive, painful things. Now it is increased access to participate in scientific conversations. So that's wonderful. Another dimension in research is in coding. I actually recently had a problem where I had created some analytic code in R, and for some unimportant reason, I needed to convert it into Python. And I'm like, oh man, I don't touch Python that often. I use it sometimes, but I you know, it's going to take me, like, I allocated like half a day, 4 to 6 hours to figure out this problem. And right when I started, I said to myself, wait a minute, maybe this is something GPT can fix for me. And so I gave it, you know, the code I was trying to convert, and it didn't completely work, but it saved a lot of time. My 4 to 6 hour project became about 45 minutes. So it was just an enormous time saver trying to solve that as well. You know, my area is industrial organizational psychology. There is an absolute explosion of generative AI in understanding how to do like trait assessment for employment, in trying to facilitate higher quality training interactions. The idea that you can have very similar to the educational piece, that you can have an interactive agent like working through automatically content and trying to explain it better to you based on your personal challenge areas. I mean, it's just an enormous amount of potential. You know, what I would say at this point is what's a little risky in applied practice is just launching in large language model to do things for you. Like I'm right now saying that keeping the human in the loop, staying in this, like, it makes draft materials that we can check. That's the safer place to stay right now. It is getting better, but right now you can just save an absolutely massive amount of time by using it to basically automate minor time-consuming tasks that we'd otherwise spend quite a lot of time on.
Well, and I love that you've spoken about the benefit from an equity perspective. You know, for example, non-native English speakers having a level playing field to submit articles in English, you know, can clean up the little idiosyncrasies of a writer. So that's fantastic. On that vein, I want to flip now and talk a little bit about some of the risks and start with that issue the issues with equity, with discrimination and bias. You know, it's one of the biggest issues I think there is in terms of the ethics for society that society really needs to grapple with along with psychologists. And my understanding is a lot of the data that's used to train the AI is basically white, affluent, Western, US centric. It's what's published. And that really can skew the results. So I'm wondering if folks have thoughts on those issues in generative AI and what are the ways to minimize those harms? Jessica, for example, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I do have thoughts on it. One of the things I encourage people to think about is that two things can be true at the same time, right? We say this all the time as a psychologist, it's the whole dialectic thing. Same thing with AI. It can be helpful and you still have responsibility, just like lots of things we use. I think this even feels like for many, when we think about the transition, for the longest time, all medical records were pen and paper, right? And we had to use that. And then people switched to an EMR and there was a lot of concern about who has access? What are people doing? It's the same thing. There's still a level of responsibility. So I think when we're using AI, it is, as a clinician, speaking from that perspective, your responsibility to check what does the software say when you read the terms? Is it saying that it is HIPAA compliant? Because many are not right now. But would you need a BAA? Do you need informed consent from your client if you're saying I'm using this information in something that feels exploratory? It's the same thing you would in like something else that's experimental, right? And I think that people need to think about what that's going to look like for their notes. And so I get that there's a lot of concern, but you also have a lot of power in being cautious and asking questions and making decisions about what you're going to want to leverage. The same way you would any other software that you would bring into your business, right? You would not buy a computer that couldn't be locked because you can't, like somebody could just open it up and see all of your notes, if that's where you take your notes. Even for things like people, even you think Zoom, for example, if people are doing sessions over Zoom and now there's the AI feature, you can ask, you can research, you can reach out to Zoom and say, is there a way, can I turn this off and see what they say? There's information out there. It just requires people to actually read it because there's a lot of unknowns. And the thing I like to remind people, I work in industry currently, is a lot of the times it's built by people who don't necessarily have all of the understanding of the healthcare system that you do. So they're thinking from a technology perspective, they may not realize things about things like a BAA or HIPAA or why that might be needed or even what PHI is. So they may not have built it with that in mind. And it's really still our duty to ask those questions and to be able to say, is this something I can use for this purpose or not?
And that extends to the population you're using it with and the population that the data comes from. I was at a conference last week and they were talking about model cards, which are, you all probably know, but sort of a summary that the manufacturer, let's call it, that's not really what it is, but would release that would really help people to understand, you know, what was the data for it? How does it work? Trying to get rid of a little of this black box idea where you really don't know how it's working. And looking at that and realizing what populations the data is coming from, and then how do you then figure it out in the use for your population, seems like a critical piece of this issue as well.
Absolutely. And I would just add that the same way that people consult now when you do things in person, consult. You don't have to figure it out yourself. There's like the Cyber One Mind Guide. They just review apps, but people could start things like that where they're reviewing different pieces of AI and giving information so that people are able to kind of crowdsource, how do I use this? Is this a compliant? Because everyone may not know where to look. So the thing is, people feel like they have to do it individually, but there's a lot of things that we learn not individually that we consult with other people on. And this is a great opportunity to do the same thing.
Yeah, and I would say too, Lindsay, first of all, just being knowledgeable about what you said to begin with, right? Where this data is being generated, like if we're thinking about the equity issue, people really understanding where the information is coming from and doing due diligence to look at that information with that knowledge and making sure that you think about that information through the lens of different populations. And I also think there's going to be a need for research on the generative AI outputs to see how do we make sure that the content is diverse, because there is so much, I think there is potential to use generative AI in a way to increase equity. I mean, even in the mental health field or larger health field, I think it could be used to create, health education or advertising materials that are diverse and speak to specific populations. But it first starts with understanding that the information itself is biased at this point.
Right.
Yeah, and let me just take that a step further. I think it's so easy to jump on AI and say, oh, look at the problems with AI, but we've got to remind ourselves that some of these problems, especially with bias, they've been in our literature for some time. I mean, there are some great 2022 articles that took a look at research done on weird populations in psychology. And, you know, the numbers are staggering. 68% of research studies are American-based, American-based, not just weird populations, American-based, right? High 80s are just coming from weird populations. So it's there. It's been in our research. It's been in our books. And yes, it's an AI, right? So let's not forget that. More importantly, and I want to tie this to one of the questions one of the attendees wrote, this is actually a great critical thinking exercise for educators, which is where the exercise or the assignment is to take ChatGPT output and review it with an eye towards bias. And I don't just do it on the side, make that an assignment. And I think that, you know, to what extent is it pulling research that's more diverse? Just a great way to take this in, face it head on.
I love that idea of using it as a critical thinking assignment. It's great, especially regarding bias.
If I could also double tap on what Regan said, because I think that's one of the criticisms that I've heard a lot too. We talked about this at APA this year, is about the bias in AI, but I encourage people in psychology to think about what are the materials we're creating now that have less bias that can feed into AI, right? So it comes from the information that's already out there. So it doesn't necessarily, it's not making up information in the way that we think of, like, it's not reinventing psychology. It is taking what has already existed. And so I think that does then require a reflective look at psychology of, like, well, what are we now publishing and coming up with that can go into it to think about it? Or even thinking about ways of how AI can be trained. So everyone doesn't get trained on working with multicultural populations or cross-cultural populations. But if you were to ask AI, any of them, a question, any of the models, that might help you to think better about your patient, right? What are some things I should be considering when I have a patient who is a different gender identity and see what it comes up with. So that's a way of it critical thinking about what are the things you're not able to think of without the training that it can remind you of, but also reflecting on what are we doing now to be able to give it unbiased information, to be able to use it in a way that feels more comfortable.
Yeah, I love that idea. It's reflecting us to ourselves, and we can really learn something from that. Richard, you talk a little bit about this in your article with Tara Berend, the recent American Psychologist article. I wondered if you had anything to add.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, the issues that we're talking about or that we've been talking about up to now are really, I mean, a lot of that was is the kind of motivation for why we wanted to tackle that piece. I'm heavily motivated by Clark's third law, which if you know science fiction, you know, is any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So there's a tendency to get into kind of magical thinking with these technologies. And it's important that we understand them well enough to figure out exactly what they're doing and where they come from. Like if you think of AI as just this sort of mystical tech force that you're able to call on and it makes decisions for you, that's not a good entry point for saying, well, let's very specifically try to identify what's happening here and what's wrong with this approach and what's going on. I mean, you know, the generative AI, especially the text-based generative AI, is based on the internet. And the internet, not a great place. There's a lot of parts of the internet that are very concerning. And so we found ourselves in this weird situation now where the models that are commonly being used, the large language models that are commonly being used, are being maintained by private industry. Companies who are trying to balance this line or walk this line between creating something that is scalable and cheap and just takes advantage of the data that are already there, but also something that people feel okay interacting with. So they take the biased internet and they apply their own sort of internal logic as to like, well, maybe we don't want it to do this nasty thing over here. So they're making these adjustments behind the scenes to make them a little more palatable to the everyday user in ways that we are not clear on. Like they don't explain exactly what they're doing, how they fine tune the models, how they are suppressing certain information, promoting other information. I mean, it's all very unclear. And so a lot of what that article was about is making that, you know, pulling it into the light of day. Like, let's say if we really want to understand bias, we need to understand exactly what's happening here, so that at least experts can go in and say, all right, I understand everywhere in this model, like what's going on. It's become very important to me in the IO space, because we have many, many standards and laws about how to identify if, for example, a hiring system is biased, and how we avoid using systems that are discriminatory. And we don't have a very clear mapping of how to use those tools in this new space. So a lot of things are happening under the hood that we need to worry more about. And step one in that is understanding exactly what they're doing in the first place, so that we can enter into meaningful conversations with the companies maintaining these platforms so that we can do some good.
That's great. Before, I think we need to move on to talk a little bit about the ethics specific to psychologists. And obviously there's overlap between that and society. But before we do, I did want to mention one other thing that comes up in reading about generative AI, and that's it's the possibility for manipulation and greater spread of disinformation and the likelihood of further social polarization based on that. So I wanted to at least, you know, mention that before we moved on. I don't know if anyone has any further comment on that.
I mean, that's pretty much what I was talking about. So like OpenAI has had to train its GPT to not be racist because a lot of the internet's racist. So like, that's the kind of thing happening here. And I don't have any way to evaluate how successful that is. It's hard to tell, like, just if they've gone far enough, have they gone too far? What's been the implication? What does it change? Who does it advantage? Who does it disadvantage? We don't have answers to any of these questions. It makes it quite the tricky ethical space, which is why I'm glad we're talking about it.
Exactly. All right, so let's talk about the ethics that are more specific to the use by psychologists. So what about, for example, Regan, in issues in education, and what are some of the ethical concerns specifically for psychologists in that educational space?
Right. So I'm glad we could kick off there, because I think, you know, when we as we teach students, students are using it. A lot of the questions in the chat from attendees have been, can you use it? What do you do with it? And of course, the question is, you know, the quick answer is, if you're using ChatGPT, cite it, right? Make it clear that you've been using ChatGPT. But I want to go from there to a few other key points for the educational realm. I think in this day and age, at this point, if you are an educator teaching a class and your syllabus does not say something about AI use, do something about it, right? That's the starting point, because in conversations with academic honesty officers or hearing officers, and they're being fed all these cases of potential plagiarism or AI use, it all comes back to, what does the syllabus say about AI use? And I think the first thing, if you are somebody teaching, make sure that your syllabus says something about AI. And mind you, if you are with the people who go, I don't care, use it if you want to, put that into language in some form, because that becomes very, very important. Students need to know. I've just popped into the chat some suggested language, so you don't have to reinvent the wheel. Here at Oregon State, our Center for Teaching and Learning and our eCampus unit has done a lot of work to help faculty out. And what you'll see on that page are actual syllabus statements that you can just cut and paste into your syllabi, right, for addressing AI. What I particularly like is we've come up with our College of Business folks came up with these really cool AI icons that signify how much AI use is acceptable for assignments. And I think that becomes really important, because it's not an all or nothing, right? Maybe there's, and I think that's this huge step towards the having AI work with us and working with AI to capitalize on what it does. So the big thing from an ethical standpoint is, it all starts with, what are you, the educator? What are you, the instructor, the teacher, saying about AI use? Do you permit it? What kind of AI use do you permit? And if it's used, how should it be cited? The last thing I'll say is something I've seen a lot is not just citing AI use, and that's been popped into the chat of how to do it in APA style, but some instructors are also suggesting uploading the prompt log. And I think that's a really nice idea, because, you know, if you upload the log of the prompts that you're having with AI, that'll make everything very, very clear. So I'll stop there.
That's great. Does anyone else on the panel have any comments, and specifically within education? I love how Regan mentioned sort of, it's basically a transparency issue, making it clear how you're using it.
Yeah, I think some of the issues going to be in education is that, like all things technology or new, let's say, there's a continuum. There are faculty who are the first adopters, who are fully embracing it and incorporating it into their teaching. And then on the other end are those who are like, no, not for me, never, kind of gonna, you know, act like it doesn't exist. And then there are a lot of people in the middle. And I think we do have an obligation as educators to educate ourselves. I don't think we can turn a blind eye. I think we owe it to our students to get up to speed and be able to use this technology in an ethical way, but in a way that does promote learning.
I think that it's not always obvious just how far this can go, and how I think this is largely student led, to be honest, because they're going to find the most current and clever ways to use things. In my I teach a doctoral level class right now in the psychology of training. And when I decided to go full GPT on everything, I'm like, just use it however you want. I just want to see what happens. And so I asked the person who got the highest score on it was an open essay exam. I asked, what did you do? I just, you know, no punishment, no judgment. I just want to hear what you did. And what she did is she wrote out an entire study guide. She then went to GPT, uploaded that study guide as a PDF, pointed it to our book, uploaded the questions that I had asked, uploaded a PDF of all of the slides that I had used in the entire unit. And then you said, using all of this information, answer this question. And that's how she got to her first draft of her answers. So, I mean, the amount of the way that these tools will be used is not up to us. this is something that will be happening regardless. And I think a lot of students are also aware that when they graduate, they're going to be going into jobs where sometimes they'll have access to this and sometimes they won't. But if they do, why wouldn't they use it? It's just, if you have a screwdriver and you're trying to turn a screw, why would you not use the screwdriver? So I think we have to go in understanding that this is just a reality that is coming at us. And I would encourage against the head in the sand approach, some degree of embracing that things are changing. And it's literally changing the nature of work itself as we move forward. It's very important for educators to keep in mind.
You know, and if I could just add to that, I just saw a great comment in the question answer that I wanted to share with everybody. Even if you personally don't care, I think you should, but that's still up to you. I think it's really important for you to check with your department chair, with your college chair, with your university, because many universities have policies or recommendations about AI use. Get with the program, see what your university says about AI use, see what your department stance is about AI use. I think that's a very, very important thing to keep in mind. So thank you for that comment in there.
Okay, I'd like to move on to its use in clinical practice and specifically the issue of confidentiality. We've touched on it a little bit earlier in the discussion, but I wondered if either Jessica or Tiffany or anyone else had any thoughts on confidentiality, compliance with HIPAA, those sorts of issues in clinical practice.
Regan said something that just stuck out to me that I think applies to this when he was saying, you know, it's changing the way that we work has to change things. I think in practice, what makes people really uncomfortable, it is going to change the way we think about clinical practice. And we have seen this before. When you think about not just clinical practice, but even how we think about work now, the revolution of it in the early 1900s, it changed when people started building these industrial cities. It changed everything about how we think about work, what a work day looks like. This is, to me, along the similar track. It can change things when we think about the ethics. And so the ethical issues that we're seeing in AI are not that different than what we're seeing in person, right? Like, we still have ethical challenges. When you're in a consultation group, there are some people who would say somebody said too much when they're trying to consult. Other people is like, that's not enough information. AI is doing the same thing. When we're thinking about things like how we're doing our notes and the way that we're protecting them in AI, we still have to make those same judgment calls as humans. There's a lot of gray area, even as humans, when we think about clinical practice. And I think that we are navigating through those. You think about our ethical codes, how often they get updated. It's not that often. And so people are continuously having to navigate, even for telehealth. Well, what's considered telehealth? And if I share something across state lines, but I don't practice across state lines, and what does that mean? And I think what feels uncomfortable for people is that we don't have these set answers, but we don't have them as humans either. It requires a lot of critical thinking and not navigating and a lot of thinking about how we work. And I think one of the ways that we can think about for AI is how do we start to think about how do we work with AI versus against it necessarily? Because people are still going to use the technology. So then it changes the way I think. If you think about it as another person, how would I bring this person into my practice? What are the things that I am looking for? What are the things that need to be determined? For areas that feel gray, how do I outline a decision tree process to determine how I'm going to move forward in something like the gray area? Because there are a lot of, I think, challenges, especially for confidentiality. But to me, they're the same challenges as using an EMR. When I work in a hospital system, how many people have access to my notes? Right? How many people can read them and make judgments about them and say, this is how I'm going to treat this patient based on that? I don't have control over that. So I have to then be determining, what am I writing in this note that meets the needs of the patient and allows me to protect their confidentiality to the degree that I can? That's the same way as how we might think about how we're using AI.
Yeah. And I would say too, in terms of your point, Jessica, that you know, the code, the APA ethics code gets revised only every so often. But I think, and I know even sometimes the principles might change, but I always try to go back to the principles. And what is that? You know, what do we need to be focused on, especially when we're in between codes and might not be the specific guidance that we want on a certain topic. And in this case, that would be generative AI and the use of it. And so, you know, with confidentiality, I think about, you know, it's the ethical principle of respecting people's rights and dignity. And so what does that mean? It means, you know, in part transparency, and yes, it should be part of informed consent, but also, and this applies to all things informed consent, it is really important that we really practice what we know, which is informed consent should not just be a document that is signed. It should be a process. We should be revisiting it. And in this area, I think we are going to, you know, need to continually revisit this aspect of how we're using generative AI in our practice with our clients. So I think that's one important first step to address some of the ethical concerns. And then, as Jessica talked about earlier, I mean, clearly we can't be sharing any personal health information, you know, if we're, you know, just in the generic ChatGPT outside of some kind of proprietary software. But if we are using generative AI, you know, to develop treatment plans, we need to be really careful about de-identification and anonymization of the information that we're sharing for the purpose of clinical practice.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting. This is also an area that's rapidly evolving. So there are companies coming out that will have AI, generative AI specifically for healthcare that hopefully will be HIPAA compliant. And so this will also change in the future, but just using ChatGPT now, you know, that's not the case. So it'll be interesting to see how this develops. I also love the idea of talking about thinking by analogy to what you're already doing. So you understand the ethical principles, you have the standards, maybe it doesn't fit exactly with generative AI, but you can think about it in terms of, well, what's analogous that I'm already doing and how do I think through that? And then how do I use it for the generative AI? So I think that's really great. And of course, all these discussions about things like confidentiality, you know, it's equally true for student confidential information or participants' data and research, all these issues come up. One other thing that I think our current ethics code focuses on is that it's that the psychologist in putting out information always has the ultimate responsibility for the scientific basis of that. And of course, we've all heard stories with generative AI of the hallucinations that it can be created, or they've created false references. I know that, you know, an attorney, for example, submitted false cases that didn't exist to the court, and that was a big issue. So what steps do you think a psychologist should be taking when they're using generative AI? How can they guard against this risk when they're using generative AI? Does anybody have any thoughts?
I think number one, it's just remembering this is a tool. It shouldn't be doing the work for us in any domain, right? Whether it's practice or education or research. It's a tool that we can use to help us. It shouldn't be doing the work for us. And it is our responsibility to verify the information, to cross-check, right? That it can still save us time. Even taking the time to verify information, we're still saving that time by using the technology. So I just think keeping in perspective that it is another tool that we can use.
Yeah, I think it's really helpful to think of it as augmenting human ability, but the psychologist has still got the responsibility to critically evaluate it, determine the final product that's being used. And I think that's interesting to me because there's also a tendency I think humans have to assume that computers are infallible. And that's not the case with this. And we also have to guard against that, because generative AI currently isn't the expert. The human, the psychologist, is still the expert in this situation and has to sort of use it, like you said, as a tool. So one other point of ethics that I want to make sure we cover before we run out of time is competence. And I know, Richard, you spoke about this a little bit in your American Psychologist article. So I wondered if you wanted to talk about general competence regarding how AI works. And then also I was really struck by the idea of how to be competent in an interdisciplinary setting when you're working with, for example, software engineers who are working on the AI.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, this is closely related actually to the last point, where, you know, understanding AI, or understanding that generative AI is more or less drawn from internet-based data, also should lead you to the conclusion that this is just like a very intricate, powerful Google search that you're doing. And it doesn't really do any more than that. So you have to understand kind of the source of the data in order to understand how much you would trust it. And on top of that, these models are trained to be very polite I don't know if you've used ChatGPT. It is very polite, but that means it will do things like if you say, hey, what is 1 + 1? And it says 2, and you tell it, no, it isn't. It'll say, oh, I'm so sorry. You must be right. And it will continue that conversation as if you were correct. So being aware of it as a prediction engine is just so fundamental to not being misled, and also understanding that it is based on, based on very fallible data. And it took a long time. I remember back, in the introduction of the internet, I'm aging myself there, the beginning of the internet, people trusted Google searches way more than they should have. And it was the same basic problem. You're like, oh, if I search for it, the computer just tells me the answer. I guess that's what I want. And it took a long time to sort of get past that, and still hard. We're facing exactly the same problem now. So anytime that it's a little bit different problem for end users versus people who are trying to develop products. For end users, I think it's an enormous minefield to try to understand exactly what is going on in these models and how much awareness and ability is necessary to use them responsibly. I think the approach I just gave is at least the starting point to understand, like, it is ultimately you. It is you're guiding a piece of software, and that's it. But for people making these platforms, I've certainly encountered a lot of folks that are in the IO psych space, who are often working with technology companies trying to create products that use AI. And sometimes it becomes obvious that the people who are on the psych side don't quite fully understand what the tech group is doing. And that is very dangerous because there are, you can see it in the way that we've been even talking now, like the way that you craft your prompts and your instructions to an AI really dramatically change the kind of content you get at the other side. And the way that the models are designed can really change what you get at the other side. And so if psych doesn't actively speak up and say, hey, I don't understand that, you need to explain this in terms that make sense to me so that we can build something that's safe and works together, then we're going to end up with possibly quite dangerous products out the other side. So I think psychologists have a responsibility, like, in this space, we're the ones that understand the humans best, hopefully. So if we're not talking about the human side of this, who is? So we need to be familiar enough with the tech to have that conversation. And then we need to be confident enough to speak up in those discussions.
It reminds me a lot that we're still struggling with the competence issue just in technology and telehealth. And it seems like this is going to be a similar struggle where, what level of understanding do you need to really be able to use these tools effectively? And it's an ongoing question to be answered. I want to take a minute, we're starting to run out of time. So I want to take a minute just to talk about APA's role, because there were a lot of questions that came in before the webinar regarding APA's role. And so I wanted to make sure everybody knows that APA has a webpage dedicated to artificial intelligence and machine learning. You can find that on our homepage. If you look for the tab at the top, it says topics. When you click on that, there's a tab that says all topics, and you can find artificial intelligence and machine learning as a specific topic, and that will give you a wealth of resources on that page. Also wanted to mention that the APA Ethics Committee is working on an FAQ, and one of the questions will be information on ethical issues related to generative AI. And then finally, the APA Ethics Code Task Force, which is writing the transformational new ethics code for psychologists for the 21st century. They're obviously considering these issues, and be on the lookout for a draft of a new code. There'll be a public comment release, and take time to read that and provide public comments. That will be really helpful to dealing with these ethical issues in the future. And of course, this webinar is the first in the series of several webinars on generative AI at APA. So I think we're really nearing the end of our time together. What I wanted to get from each panelist, what would one takeaway be, just a short takeaway that you would like the attendees to consider as they leave the session? Who wants to start?
Oh, I'm going to, because I wanted to jump off something Tiffany said. Remember this, AI is super fast, but it may not always be faster if you have to take the time to check it for accuracy and seeing what it's doing and so on and so forth. There are some times when just old school writing yourself is a much more efficient way to go. Just wanted to say that.
Jessica, you have a final thought?
Yes, I would just offer to people, especially for practitioners, clinical judgment is real. It's what we're trained in. So use your clinical judgment when using these tools about how you're using them in your practice and with patients, because you've been trained to fine-tune that judgment.
Tiffany.
Yeah, I just would encourage everybody to, again, really revisit the ethical principles for your profession, right? So for psychologists, right, we have the five principles in our ethics code, and to really look at those principles and then ask yourself some questions about how best to use generative AI in a way that is consistent with those principles.
Great. Richard, final thought.
Last word. It's a lot of pressure. I would just say don't be afraid. It is far more accessible than you think. I mean, I saw it's like a third of the folks here hadn't even tried it. Go try it. Like right now, it takes you 5 seconds. Go, run into Bing AI, get a free ChatGPT account, and just see what it does. That is the starting point for learning, and I think we all have at least that much responsibility to just experience what our, students, patients, and everybody else are definitely using. We need to be a part of that too.
Well, thank you all for the panel. This was a great conversation. Thanks to everyone who was viewing. As soon as the webinar has ended, a short survey will be visible on your screen, and please take a few minutes to complete the survey and provide your comments. Also, I want to remind you to join us on December 6th for the next APA webinar. It's entitled The Role of Psychology and How to Navigate Change. And we're chatting out a link now so you can learn more and register. Thanks so much. Bye, everyone.